The Fly on the Ceiling, a Math Myth by Dr. Julie Glass and illustrated by Richard Walz. This is a story of a guy who lived a long time ago. He lived in France. He was a French guy, so he had a French name. His name was René Descartes. This may sound a little funny name to you, but in France, it is a perfectly normal. René was a philosopher. A philosopher is someone who thinks about why things are the way they are. René was a great philosopher. Many of his ideas are still famous today. But even though René was a great philosopher, he did have one problem. He was messy. This problem started out small, but it got bigger and bigger. The funny thing was, René did not know he had a problem until he started to lose things. His notebook, his favorite hat, his book about stars, his inkwell. Then he found the inkwell. Now, René knew he had a problem. This must stop, René said to himself. He decided to take a walk and try to think of a solution to his problem. It took him a moment to find his coat, his hat, and the front door. René went to his favorite bakery to buy a fresh loaf of bread. Then he headed to his favorite place to think, the banks of the river Seine. René ate some of the bread while he walked. He looked at the water and wondered how he could keep better track of his things. Night fell and René was still thinking. He was thinking so hard that he didn't look where he was going. Into the Seine went René Descartes. When he was fished out of the water, he was cold and wet, and his bread was soggy. René walked home. By the time he got there, he was sneezing and wheezing. He crawled into bed and fell fast asleep. The next morning, René still felt dreadful. Not only that, but he couldn't find his handkerchief, or an extra blanket, or the logs to make a fire. He couldn't even find his soggy bread, which should have dried out by then. René crawled sadly back into bed. He stared at his ceiling. The ceiling was the only place in his room that wasn't messy. René wished that he lived on the neat ceiling instead of on the messy floor. Just then, he noticed a fly on the ceiling. The fly flew off and landed near one corner. Then it flew off and landed in another corner. Then it landed above René's toes. Then it stopped right over René's head. René started to think. He wondered if the fly ever landed in the same place twice. This might seem like a weird thing to think about, but René was a philosopher, so it was normal for him. I need to record where the fly lands so I can know how many times it lands in the same place, he thought. But how can I do that? René thought and thought. Suddenly, he had a brilliant idea. It was so brilliant, he jumped out of bed and did a jig. He knew how to record exactly where the fly landed on the ceiling. René took a piece of charcoal from the fire, then he climbed up on a chair and started drawing lines on the ceiling. Don't try this at home. Your parents won't like it. First, René drew lines from the north wall to the south wall. Next, he drew lines from one side to the other. Then he numbered the lines along two of the walls. After that, he got into bed. René watched the fly on the ceiling. When it landed, he counted the lines over to the spot. He wrote down the number of lines. 2. Then he counted the lines up to that spot. He wrote down the number 5. Together, the two numbers, 2 and 5, told him exactly where the fly was. The numbers 2 and 5 are called coordinates. The first coordinate, 2, measures how far away the fly is from the left side. The second coordinate, 5, measures how far away the fly is from the bottom wall. Renee spent the whole morning watching the fly and sneezing. If he had gone to visit him, he might have said, "The fly is 6 over, 3 up. Or the fly is 4 over, 7 up. Or the fly is 8 over, 1 up. Every spot on the ceiling had its own set of coordinates. Coordinating the coordinates of the fly over and over again gave Renee another brilliant idea. Maybe he could keep track of his stuff the same way he kept track of the fly. It would be even easier because a hat can't get up and fly away. Renee jumped out of bed again. He pushed everything into the kitchen. Now the floor of his room was as clean as the ceiling, but he couldn't draw the grid on the floor with charcoal. It would rub off too soon. Renee went next door to see if his neighbor had any paint. What luck! His neighbor was a painter. Renee and the painter painted a grid on Renee's floor. Then they went to the bakery to buy bread. By the time they got back, the paint had dried. The painter helped Renee put his things in place on the grid. They found Renee's hat, his star book, his quill pens, his old boots, his journal from when he was 10, and many other things that Renee didn't even know were missing. On a chart, Renee carefully recorded where everything went. Voila! After that, Renee's home was never messy again. Well, hardly ever. Renee's system caught on around the world. It was called the Cartesian coordinate system. Cartesian comes from Renee's last name, Descartes. Today, people still use the Cartesian coordinate system in many different ways. The author's note. Okay, so maybe Rene Descartes wasn't really messy, and maybe he didn't really fall into the sin or draw lines on his ceiling. But even if nobody knows exactly how he did it, it is a fact that Rene Descartes made the Cartesian coordinate system very popular. And he was a darn good philosopher too. The end.
Hello, I hope you enjoyed today's math story. So the next part is for teachers and parents. And I'm gonna go over with you are some math standards and the grade levels that touch on these standards so you know when to use this story. Also, if you click on the below link, you'll see some resources that I found online that are free. And that way you can continue on with the learning.
Now let's go ahead and talk about the math standards that relate to this story. So in grade 3, this is the 3 representing the grade level, and then MD represents standards. So in this case, it's standard of measurement and data, and the C is going to be our cluster of 6 parts right here. It states that the students will do measure areas by counting unit squares. So they will use the grid format of the squares to do some counting. So that's going to be in grade 3. In grade 4, under still the standard of measurement and data, students will make a line plot to display a data set of measurements in fractions of a unit, 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, to solve problems involving addition and subtraction of fractions by using information presented in line plots. Now in grade 5, it's very similar to grade 4. They're also going to go ahead and make a plot of display of data sets of measurements in fraction of units of 1/2, 1/4, and 1/8, But in this case, instead of doing addition and subtraction, they're going to use operations on fractions for this grade to solve problems involving information presented in line plots. In middle school, grade 6, we have a standard of statistics and probability, and the cluster of B right there says that they will display numerical data in plots on a number line, including dot plots, histograms, and box plots. In grade 8, the standard is function right here. They will construct a function to model a linear relationship between two quantities, determine the rate of change, and the initial value of the function from a description of a relationship or from two XY values. So they will be plotting slopes and graphing linear equations, and so that is what it is related to. Also, they will be describing qualitatively the function relationship between two quantities by analyzing a graph. For example, when the function is increasing or decreasing, and it's if it is a linear or non-linear equation. And in high school, for the standard of functions, same thing, but a little subpart of that function is going to be interpreting functions right here. And students will be understanding that a function from one set called the domain to another set called the range. So they'll be working with domains and range. The other one is graphing linear and quadratic functions to show intercepts, maxima, and minima. They will also be graphing square roots, cube root, and piecewise defined functions. Also, we have students graphing polynomial functions, identifying zeros when suitable factorizations are available, and showing end behaviors. And also graphing exponential and logarithmic functions, showing intercepts and end behavior, and trigonometric functions showing period, midline, and amplitude.
Goodbye. We'll see you at the next math story.